Hello everyone, hope you all are fine, and today we will be continuing our discussion with hydrogen. I have received two doubts. One of them was regarding redox. It is asked that whether we need to balance equation always using ion electron method or not. See, the question comes balance using ion electron method. It's a question that comes, and also oxidation number method, sometime it comes. Now, ion electron method balancing, if you all know, you all must be knowing that in I discussed also in normality calculation, sometime you need the number of the electron transfer, and also in class 12 we have electrochemistry chapter where we discuss where we have numericals based on Nernst equation. There you need the number of electron transfer in the process. Otherwise, you always need to do or not, that's up to you. Like in inorganic chemistry, if you are getting a question, the right balanced chemical equation, there what you will do, that's up to you. Like if you know the balancing directly, you can write, or if you know any method where you can do the balancing very rapidly, you can do that. But this is a question that comes, the balance using ion electron method. Second question was regarding the orthohydrogen and parahydrogen. It's asked that spinning, it's not the spinning of electrons. Spinning of electron that occurs always with Pauli's exclusion principle, as you all know. Electrons are always in the antiparallel spin. But here in the hydrogen molecules, two hydrogen atoms, protons are there, so near will be nuclear spinning. If there is parallel nuclear spinning, then it is orthohydrogen, and if there is antiparallel nuclear spinning, then it is parahydrogen. So for parallel nuclear spinning, ortho, and for anti-parallel nuclear spinning, that is para. It's not, do not mix up with the electron spinning. It's the nuclear spinning. Hydrogen has only one proton, so we can talk about, we can say it's proton as well. Now in the next part of the syllabus, we have water. Previously we have seen some reactions of hydrogen. Today we have water. Water and hydrogen peroxide, these two we have in the syllabus as a compound of hydrogen. Now, whenever we talk about water, first thing that comes is about the 4 degree centigrade concept, that is density of water, anomalous expansion of water, that we read in physics from class 6, and it was there in class 9, class 8 chemistry as well. Now, 4 degree centigrade temperature, the density is highest, the volume is lowest. And the range of 0 degree to 4 degree centigrade, in that range particularly, when we increase the temperature, instead of increasing volume, the volume decreases. And if you decrease the temperature, the reverse and vice versa that happens. Now, the reason, basically, what is the reason that is known to us, because we have done the X-ray refraction pattern, we know the structures inside. The water itself has a open V-shaped structure. It's like zigzag molecules, number of water molecules, n number of water molecules are joined, zigzag form and open structure. Now, when it is form of ice, the structure is like diamond shaped, very rigid, strong. And during this change from 0 degree to 4 degree centigrade, we are increasing the temperature, the hexagonal shape of the ice comes. That means from the diamond like structure, tetrahedral structures, to the hexagonal shape, during this transformation there is a squeezing of the molecular structure. As it is a squeezing, that means volume decreases, and we know D is equal to M by V. As the volume decreases, density increases. This happens. Now, why it happens only with water molecule, that reason is not that much known to us, because so many solvents are there. Among all the solvents, water shows this property so widely, and as this anomalous expansion is present, that is why the life is actually existing in the earth. Life would have not been there, it could have, this anomalous expansion, if it was not there. Because previously in the ice age, you all know, you have heard about ice age, the initial animal, amoeba, or the animal which forms, basically the life was created in the water. Would have been no anomalous expansion, would have all the water frozen, and no life, this progress of life would have not seen, basically. But so that as anomalous expansion is there, so the life is there. So that's why it's very important fact. Now coming back to other properties like 0 degree to 100 degree centigrade, freezing point to boiling point, those I'm not discussing. It's a colorless liquid. We have different reactions of water. Maximum of these reactions are also known to all, like I'm not writing all those, like metals when you are adding to water, hydrogen forms, and it the reaction entirely depends on the electrochemical series. There hydrogen is the standard, lead which is above hydrogen and does not react with water because that insoluble compound forms, and copper and all, they do not react. Non-metal also they react, like fluorine if reacts with water it forms HF, and chlorine it reacts it forms HCl. Hydrolysis is an important fact. Hydrolysis is a reaction where generally we get to see the basic or the ions from which the molecules are generated. Like aluminium carbide, when it is hydrolyzed, we get methane. When we hydrolyze calcium carbide, we get acetylene and calcium hydroxide. When nitrites like magnesium nitride and calcium nitride, aluminium hydrides and aluminium nitrides are hydrolyzed, then we get ammonia and their hydroxides. We have seen this part. Water is amphiprotic in nature. Amphiprotic means water can behave as acid when it reacts with an alkali, and can behave as base when it is reacting with an acid. So if you are adding HCl to water, we get H3O plus and Cl minus. When we are adding NH3 to water, we get NHO plus and OH minus. Now here one term comes, that is called conjugate ions, conjugate acid base pair theory. Those who have started equilibrium, you know that we have the concept, different concepts of defining acid base, like Bronsted-Lowry theory, then Lewis acid concept, Arrhenius theory, hard and soft acid base rule. Different types of concepts we have. So based on that, we have this concept that water, or better to say, if you define acid, acids are proton donor and bases are proton acceptor. Strong acids, after releasing the H plus, the ion, that conjugate ion remains, will be weak, and vice versa. And for bases, after accepting proton, the conjugate ion that we are getting, that will be strong. Strong acids conjugate ion is a weak base, and weak base conjugate ion is a strong acid. Similarly, weak acid conjugate ion is a strong base. That means acetic acid, if it is a weak acid, after releasing H plus ion, the ions which remain, that is acetate ion, that is actually strong. That's a strong base. Similarly, HCl, after releasing H plus, Cl minus that remain, that's weak, that is weak alkali. NH3 is a weak base, but NH4 plus is a strong acid. So whenever HCl we are adding to water, we are getting an acid base reaction. Similarly, when we are adding ammonia to water, we are getting an acid base reaction. So that's why water is called amphiprotic. It's an amphiprotic solvent. That can be that's a very important fact of water. Now here we have another thing, hard water and soft water. Basic ideas you all have about hard water and soft water, that calcium, magnesium, soluble salt, if it is there, then it is hard water. And then hard water is distinguished as classified as temporary and permanent hard water. And then soft water, basic difference, like soap lathering forms lather with soap if the water sample, then it is soft water. If does not lather with soap, then it is hard water. Now soap is a fatty acid. It can be palmitic acid and it can be stearic acid salt. So when we are adding water to soap, now if the water contains calcium salt and magnesium salt that react with the salt of stearic acid and palmitic acid which is present in the soap and form insoluble calcium stearate or calcium palmitate, which actually gives as forms of precipitation as calm generate, and we say that lather is not forming, the foams are not generating, then we call it is a hard water. Now how to remove the hardness of water? There are techniques to remove temporary hard water and the permanent hard water as well. Generally for temporary removal of temporary hardness of water, we use a boiling, or we use the Clark method. Clark method means treating with calcium hydroxide. And if we want to remove the permanent hardness of water, in that case either we use washing soda or we use Calgon process when we are treating with sodium salt. So this can be a methods to removal of temporary and permanent hardness of water. And Like water, as we know, hydrogen has two more isotopes like deuterium and tritium, and as H2O is normal water, similarly if we replace hydrogen with deuterium, we get D2O, which is a heavy water. Generally, exhaustive electrolysis of water, alkaline water, gives us deuterium. 48 hours of continuous electrolysis, 7 repeated units, and then we get some part of D2O isolating from the alkaline water, means water added with alkali. So this D2O is having uses in nuclear reactor. It's used as a moderator in the nuclear reactor. D2O has very similar properties like water. It can react with metals like sodium. If it reacts with D2O, it forms NaOD. Like NaOH, it forms NaOD. Similarly, MgOD holds 2. And also D2O on hydrolysis form deuterium gas like hydrogen gas. So these are about the reactions and all this of hydrogen. As I was telling, the water is amphiprotic. That means if we are adding HCl to water, it forms H3O plus and Cl minus. So it's HCl, which is an acid, and water, it's acting as base here. That's why we call it amphiprotic, because similarly it reacts with ammonia as well, NH3 plus H2O. It forms NH4OH, that means NH4 plus and OH minus. So this is the way it is possible for water to react with HCl and as well as ammonia to form this kind of reaction. We call it amphiprotic. Now another reaction I was talking about, D2O, which is heavy water. If sodium hydroxide reacts with D2O, so similarly as it reacts with H2, it forms NaOD and H2. Similarly, in this way it reacts. Now deuterium has some reactions. Now yes, this hard water, soft water, removal of hardness, softness, those reactions I'm not showing you, as these reactions are already mentioned in the book, and some of those reactions you have done also, like treating with sodium carbonate and then calcium salt, chlorides and sulfates. So it have done this reaction, and also during the this treatment, Calgon process and all, only the reaction you need to do, that with the sodium salt, the reaction of hard water. So you try practicing the reactions in organic chemistry, as you know, basic ideas, and then the reactions, conjugate acid base pair theory. If you have not read, you can go through that and you can send me the doubts as well. Take care. See you in the next week. Bye.